They're reckless. They don't care. They think that they can get away with it.
Brazen heists, you have to see to believe.
Well, this was not Ocean's 11. These guys drove away with two vehicles worth more than $400,000.
I would definitely call this a crime spree.
Audacious attempts to pull off outlandish crimes with minimal attempts to hide them.
I was surprised, you know, for the value they were going after here, they would send someone like that in.
There is no logic at all in how this robbery was committed. None.
But in the world of crime, audacity is not enough.
The plan didn't work. It wasn't going to work. It wasn't thought out well.
His MO, as captured on several home surveillance cameras, break into cars, homes, grab the keys, and go.
In the fall of 2021, Milwaukee residents are in the crosshairs of a serial car thief.
I rewinded the video camera, and I seen a guy coming up the driveway, and I was like, holy shit, it was this guy. Something needs to be done above and beyond.
The man's bright and early antics have been caught on camera, but he evades capture.
As this lengthy criminal complaint highlights, he's accused of breaking into homes and stealing cars in several communities, striking as early as 5 or 6 a.m.
This is the definition of a brazen heist. My name is Adam Jack. I'm the chair of the Department of Criminal Justice and Social Science at Waynesburg University. I've investigated numerous thefts in my career, thefts of very expensive items and thefts of non-expensive items.
So cars are a desirable target because, for one, they are easily movable, and two, easily resellable, and especially resellable for parts. I'm Shalon Young, a professor of practice at University of Pittsburgh School of Law, and I will be giving my impressions on videos that I've seen.
Police allege that in just 2 weeks, this particular Wisconsin gentleman may have been responsible for 15 stolen car incidents and multiple break-ins to homes in the area.
15 cars in 2 weeks is quite a successful crime spree, I would say.
He definitely has been a serious problem for us.
He was obviously stealing these vehicles with a purpose and targeting these particular vehicles. It wasn't someone leaving the engine running in a convenience store. This is someone that was targeting specific vehicles at specific locations.
Both front doors of my 2008 Blue Suburban were wide open.
Jeffrey Cooper takes his dog out when he notices the notorious car thief going through his SUV.
As I see the occupant get back into his car, I immediately came back into the house, dialed 911.
When you do it once and get away with it, it's easier to do it twice. When you do it twice and get away with it, it's easier to do it three times. I think that's what's happened in this particular case. He wasn't getting caught, so he just kept getting more brazen and more bold in his attempt to take these vehicles.
Wisconsin police eventually arrest and charge the man with 17 felonies, including burglary, theft, and operating a motor vehicle without the owner's consent for alleged incidents going back to 2019. The man pleads guilty to some of those charges as part of the plea deal and is sentenced to over 7.5 years in prison.
I'm not shocked with the severe sentence in this case because this was, in fact, a very brazen heist.
With the prolific sticky-fingered man behind bars, residents can finally breathe a little easier.
We weren't sleeping. You know, we're looking at the cameras before we go out the house. It's like, to take out the garbage, you're looking at the cameras. You could at least, you know, get a little bit of sleep.
Going into your home is such an invasion of your privacy. Getting him into custody clears up probably about 20-some incidents.
Hopefully people feel better now that this person's crime spree is over.
I was surprised that, you know, for the value they were going after here, they would send someone like that in.
Those are some precious stones.
In March 2017, a woman in South Florida walks into a local jewelry store. The prospective buyer has been communicating with the owner by email, telling him she's a potential buyer from overseas.
There was a lot of forward work done with the grooming of the relationship and the back and forth before the woman showed up to actually take possession and purchase the jewels.
We were corresponding for about a month back and forth, offering them several different diamonds that they were interested in. They gave me specifics of what they were looking for, but we showed them what we had in stock and they picked a few stones.
So the experience shopping at a high-end jewelry store is a very personal one, at least in my experience. Oftentimes the salespeople will take a person into a private room, show them the merchandise, and allow them to choose that way.
The store owner brings the woman to the vault to inspect multiple rings valued at nearly $7 million.
After inspecting 8 out of the 11, she said, okay, let's just pack them up. She was very nervous. She brings out her own packaging material to seal them, which is another red flag. We usually package it in our own material.
I would be very cautious. I would watch them carefully.
It is very uncommon for someone to bring their own packaging materials to a large multi-million dollar purchase like this. Now, if it was a lockbox or something like that where it would be packaged at the store and they want to put it in a locked container, I could see that. But this person was trying to package the diamonds into what would look like a makeshift little purse. That would be a huge red flag for me.
Then, the store owner witnesses the customer attempt a shady swap. She's an imposter who has a slightly different idea of how this exchange is going to play out.
She grabbed her briefcase, grabbed my package of stones that her and I sealed together, put it in her bag, and brought out another package, looks just like it, that she had pre-made.
Someone coming into the jewelry store with their own pre-made packaging is definitely unique. It would be a pretty smart way to pull off such a heist if this woman was able to exchange one package for another.
The store owner is aware of what she's trying to do, so he devises his own plan. He gets up to leave the vault and locks it with the woman still inside.
We're watching the video cameras and she started ripping up the fake package and actually trying to shove them up her skirt.
Yeah, this store owner did absolutely the right thing. He trusted his gut. He realized something was off. He realized the monetary value of the diamonds that he had just handed to this woman. And so he made the right decision to just get out of that location, lock the door, and wait for the police to come to sort it out. If by chance she had the money and she was going to buy it, well, then you move on from there. But as we well know, this was doomed from the beginning.
Locking the perpetrator in the vault was brilliant and hilarious to watch, too.
The woman is arrested and charged in 2017 for grand theft and organized fraud and enters a not guilty plea. As of May 2023, those charges still remain open and court records suggest the suspect is at large.
My advice to those jewelry store owners or any store, trust your gut. You do this for a living. If you think something's off, it probably is.
Up next, a stolen vintage car makes it to the international black market.
They loaded all the parts right into this box truck. By 8 o'clock in the morning, they were gone.
This is very rare that you see this much detail. It's more often the smash and grab.
Talbot Lago is a former French car manufacturer whose cars today can fetch millions. In 2001, a rare 1938 model valued at $10 million is about to leave a Wisconsin garage and go on the ride of its life.
And this particular car is one of the most beautiful examples of aerodynamics made into the body of a car with a high performance engine and chassis. So it was like a sleek race car in beautiful clothing.
There are not a whole lot of antique exotic cars, and they're also very easy to identify. I would liken it to the market for a stolen Picasso.
Early one weekend, a group looks to steal the car from the garage where it's been repaired. They move with incredible precision and speed, breaking down the vehicle into parts.
On Sunday morning, they put on white overalls and backed up a truck to the garage door to make it look like it was a legit loading. They loaded all the parts right into this box truck, and I think by 8 o'clock in the morning, they were gone.
When you have a vintage painting or an antique car taken, someone obviously knows the value. They've taken the time to line everything up so that it can happen as swiftly as possible to lessen the risk of being caught in it.
They would also be cautious not to leave behind traces of themselves, such as fingerprints, DNA, would likely wear gloves.
The rogue car collector isn't done. 4 years later, in 2005, he ships the car to Europe by treating it like a Lego kit.
With an item this rare, the only way to get it out of the country is exactly what happened, is to take it apart and ship it in pieces, or transport it in pieces, then put it back together in a different location. There's no way that this car could have gone on a cargo ship in a container or any other method for getting it to another country. I don't believe that it would change the value of the vehicle if a trained person would have put it back together the way that it was originally. But in some cases, if you own a classic car and have to take it apart and put it back together, it certainly could affect the value in the long run.
10 years later, the gentleman sells the car for over $7 million to an Illinois-based collector. Unaware the car is Hot Wheels, the collector sues to get their money back.
Yeah, this is a tough one. The person that purchased it obviously thought they were purchasing it in a legitimate purchase, and so they have a claim to it.
The taker and seller is arrested in Europe and extradited back to the United States.
People try to evade capture all the time. Some people are able to be on the run for years and years. House arrest and electronic monitoring often don't work. I've seen multiple people cut off ankle bracelets and make a run for a different country or a different state or try to assume a different identity. It happens all the time.
The man is indicted on 4 counts of wire fraud and 1 count of transportation of a stolen vehicle in foreign commerce in 2019. As of May 2023, those charges are still pending in federal court.
You know it's a very serious case when the FBI contacts Interpol to liaise with them with these other nations and agencies.
It's comforting to see the system work.
Breaking overnight, a Lamborghini dealership is a crime scene right now.
Well, this was not Ocean's 11. These guys drove away with 2 vehicles worth more than $400,000. And all it really took was a rock and a group of teenagers.
For luxury car enthusiasts, the Lamborghini Urus is a hot commodity.
Lamborghinis can run hundreds of thousands of dollars depending on how rare they are. They are not driving around every day in most cities in the United States.
Car dealerships in general would be potential targets for burglars because of the value of the cars that are there and the amount.
Early one morning in February 2020, burglars have the $200,000 SUVs in their sight. They notice an opportunity to steal the exotic rides from a Massachusetts dealership and take it, along with a Chevy Cruze.
Police say the thieves just grabbed a big rock, threw it through a glass window, and took off.
They broke in, they were able to obtain some keys from an area. They were able to remove the keys, take the cars that were in the front lot, and drive away.
What struck me was the fact that these burglars knew how to get the cars out of the dealership.
Less than 5 hours later, the 2 stolen Lambos are spotted roughly 20 miles from the dealership.
Those teens were on the run for hours, their pre-dawn high-end heist drawing early morning news coverage. Viewers spotted the pair of luxury SUVs speeding and called police. She told officers it looked like young boys were driving.
Nearby, police spot 3 suspicious vehicles, but only successfully stop one, the Chevy Cruze.
Yeah, you're a little undermanned if you're chasing a Lamborghini in a standard issue police car or police SUV. I don't think you'd be able to keep up for very long.
The 2 Lamborghini SUVs take off at high speed down the highway.
High speed chases are inherently dangerous, and the higher speed you are traveling, the more chance there is that somebody's gonna get hurt. So in most cases that I've been in high speed pursuits, sergeants will call them off relatively quick if there's general public that could be in danger.
With the 2 Lamborghinis escaping the first officer, a call is made to the surrounding areas to search for the stolen vehicles.
So we'll call ahead to other units that are ahead of the chase. Sometimes they can, you know, throw out spike strips, or they can do things to inhibit the person from continuing on.
Take a closer look at this fender bender.
Down the road, the 2 Lambos crash into a car stopped at a red light.
The fact is that when you're traveling fast, you have less time to react. And in a car like that that goes 0 to 60 that quickly, you're going fast and you can't slow down.
That is going to be one costly repair.
These people that were driving these cars just didn't know how to handle a high-end vehicle like that that could travel that fast.
2 suspects are arrested in connection with the incident.
The fact is, you're not going to get away.
1 suspect pled guilty to negligent operation of a motor vehicle, and the other pled guilty to reckless operation of a motor vehicle.
It was a very brazen heist for them to steal these high-end vehicles.
Coming up, turns out the third time isn't a charm for one man in Wisconsin.
Stealing three rings in a short period of time is pretty bold.
He isn't the first person to try and steal a ring with a phony story.
In July 2019, a man walks into a local mall and heads into a jewelry store, hoping to take a look at a few items.
Gave the employees a story about how he wanted to purchase a ring, some different ones that he wanted to look at.
I think jewelry stores in the mall, certainly just like a jewelry store that's in a standalone location, have to be concerned with the people coming in and making sure that they are not seeing those red flags of someone trying to confuse them or see multiple items at one time.
While inside the store, the man asks to see multiple rings, says he's looking for something for his fiance.
It would be common for potential thieves to come in and use phony stories to gain access to the rings.
The alleged engaged lover boy picks up a $17,000 ring, taking a closer look at it. He then asks to see another ring. And that's when the ring he was just holding magically disappears.
He does physically hold the ring, tries to take a picture of it, and then tries to kind of hide it between his thumb and his palm. And then while moving his phone to cover over the top of the ring, trying to show the employees that he doesn't have it in his hands anymore.
The resale market for stolen rings is pretty high. There are a lot of online sites that do resale of jewelry. And unless it is a piece of jewelry that's easily traceable and easily identified, it would be pretty easy to resell.
The man appears to drop the ring in his pocket.
People try and hide things in hidden pockets. I have seen people hide things under the sole of their shoe. I've seen people hide things in their bra or clothing has an extra pocket you wouldn't expect.
When the clerk asks for the ring back, he denies having it and leaves the store. The man promises employees he'll return with his ID tomorrow.
In a jewelry store like this, it is typically not gonna happen. I haven't seen many of these over the years where someone confused the worker enough that they were able to walk out the door with it.
The next day, police apprehend the Lord of the Rings after a separate call is made about him possessing a gun. They learn he's a bit of a mall rat. Police allege that he had stolen two other rings from stores in that same mall not long before.
If it were me, I would be trying to go to different locations, not the same mall.
My thought is, on this crime, the gentleman got away with it the first time and probably felt empowered to go back and do it again. When no one came after him after the first theft, he went and committed the second. When no one came after him after the second theft, he went to the third, and that's typically what happens. They won't stop until they are caught.
Police get their man, but they don't get the ring. They allege it was lost on a dice game bet.
He didn't work to buy that ring, so it was easy for him to try and gamble it away, double his money or whatever on a dice game.
The man pleads guilty to possession of a firearm by an out-of-state felon and two counts of retail theft. As of May 2023, he was awaiting sentencing.
It doesn't shock me that this gentleman went in more than once to a similar location because it worked the first time.
When he kicks through this, I think he cuts the back of his leg pretty badly.
There's not a lot of finesse in this particular crime.
In September 2015, two people target an Ohio fine jewelry store. They kick through the glass front door before moving to the second door, using screwdrivers to break in.
They risked really injuring themselves, first of all, and second, they could have gotten in a different way. They didn't need to kick through the glass.
Certainly, if that door is alarmed, it's gonna set an alarm off.
They immediately make their way to a jewelry case.
He grabbed what he could, and you can see in the films that as he's trying to pull some rings, pendants, things out, police are coming. You can tell he's quickly trying to get out of the building.
The pair run down the stairwell but realize it isn't connected to the garage where they parked their getaway car.
Typically, if you're gonna go into a jewelry store and try and take a large dollar amount of jewels, you probably should have thought through it, how you were gonna get out of there, and these folks obviously did not. They went down the stairs and couldn't get out that way and end up in the elevator.
In my experience, people visit the Target location pretty often to take a look for things such as surveillance cameras, points of entry, points of exit.
So the pair hopped into this elevator, and once they hit the garage level, got stuck.
Elevators get stuck all the time. Why on earth would these people get in the elevator to run away from their crime?
Detectives say they stashed the jewelry, including 26 diamond rings, in the ceiling.
I don't know why these two would stash the jewels in the roof of the elevator. If anyone has ever been on an elevator, all you have to do is look up and you'll see that there's usually a security camera.
Believe it or not, the pair actually cased the mall, and footage of their clearly flawed scout also becomes evidence.
Someone came in, walked around, looked a little different, asked a few questions, and we got on the tape, you know, got on my cameras. It was him.
There is no logic at all in how this robbery was committed. None.
If you're walking into a store, you're on camera. And many of those systems maintain that database for a period of time, then they automatically, you know, tape over. So for an investigator in any robbery case or burglary case like this, it's valuable for us to get to that data, that video, very quickly to look back through and see. Some aspects were thought out and some weren't. It's an anomaly. It's odd.
Police arrive on the scene and arrest the pair. They find all but one of the stolen rings until they bring the woman back to the station. The woman walks through the metal detector at HQ, and the last missing ring shows up on the scanner.
Usually preparation is a good thing. In this situation, the one person caught on camera visiting the store beforehand was a bit of a bad idea because he just provided law enforcement with his picture and with an identification.
Later, the pair are convicted and sentenced for burglary.
Strictly because of the absolute rapid speed these police got here, he failed miserably. The plan didn't work. It wasn't going to work. It wasn't thought out well.
I would define a brazen heist as a theft that took a lot of guts for someone to do and probably put a lot of other people at jeopardy.
And you wouldn't think in your normal discussion of a theft or a heist of it being that chaotic.
The more brazen the heist, the less likely your chance of escape.
The fact is, you're not going to get away.